Mr. Andy Ngo, NGO on Twitter. Mr. Andy Ngo, welcome to the program.
Welcome.
How are you doing? First of all, everything all recovered? We worry about you.
I still have issues with memory. I've had quite intensive physical, occupational, cognitive speech therapy since we last spoke. Unfortunately, what's at the top of my mind, though, is that it's nearing 5 months since my beating and robbery, and there's not been a single arrest in Portland.
Is there movement in that direction? Are they working with you? Are they contemplating doing that?
Are they interested?
Yeah.
Do they act like they're interested?
To me, it doesn't seem like they are even acting like they're interested. I haven't heard from the detective in months, and my recent attempts to start contact again have not resulted in anything yet.
Isn't that something that we should develop a media campaign around and shame them into action?
Maybe we should have Lori call and see if we can get somebody on the air to talk about it. Have them come on our show. Be like, hey, would you like to talk about the Andy Ngo case and how that's moving along and see if that gets them to do anything?
I would appreciate that. Thank you.
Okay. Mental note, Lori, on it.
Yeah.
So Ann Coulter, I heard her on Larry O'Connor's show talking about her illustrious performance, or her, what does she call it? Triumphant performance. It was perfect. It was so funny. And but she is concerned that merely for her to get up and climb onto a podium, it cost taxpayers something like, did she say $4 million?
Oh, boy.
What do we do with this, Andy?
Yeah, so for your listeners, just to recap what happened last night, more than 1,000 far-left protesters amassed at UC Berkeley to try to shut down the College Republicans event that featured Ann Coulter. Multiple police agencies had to mobilize to protect the building where she was speaking. As you probably recall, it was at UC Berkeley at the beginning of 2017 that many of these same Antifa groups that were involved last night rioted at that time and started fires and basically destroyed part of the campus. Even with that really heavy police presence, the agitators were still able to tried to disrupt the event by forming human walls where they linked arms to physically repel people who are trying to get to Wheeler Hall. I think this would be something like a 2019 version of book burning. I mean, books can be all access online. So what these people are doing to try to stop the access of information is to physically intimidate those who would go to events.
Isn't that illegal?
Well, you would think so. And thumbs up to UCPD. They made multiple arrests of mass people last night. And I think it's important to note the close link between campus radicalism as well as outside Antifa groups by any means necessary, as well as refused fascism, were there last night. So it wasn't just students. Outside agitators came in to help lead this effort to shut down a legal organized event by students on campus.
Yeah, and one thing that I always hate is that people come to make their point or to let their feelings be heard, what have you. I always hate the masked face thing, right? Like you think you have big balls, right? You think you want to come and you want to make a statement and you want to be all big and badass, yet you got to cover your face. Why? Why you got to cover your face? Are you doing something illegal? Are you threatening to harm somebody? You don't want to show your face. But when I was watching these videos last night of like, you know, Anne having to be escorted in through behind, you know, armed police and, you know, they're all lined up trying to protect her and they're escorting in very fast. It's like these students are standing there and they're screaming at her, F you, bitch, and F Ann Coulter, and they're chanting to her. And I'm thinking to myself, I was not brought up like this. There are a lot of people I don't agree with, whether it's politics or anything else in life. And it never occurs to me that I'm going to yell F you somebody's name or call them some derogatory thing because, ooh, they have the gall to come speak at the university that I'm at, or even if it's just in my town, if I don't go to Berkeley. And I'm just thinking, what have we come to that these people are spouting such, you know, because they're scared of thought? I mean, what have we come to, Andy?
Well, what we've come to is there are certain isolated areas in the United States, like some university campuses, like the city of Portland, where those in government, local government, or in this case, the city council, as well as university administrators, actively encourage this type of physical, quote unquote, resistance to the right and people
ideas
closely. Yes.
I mean,
yes.
You know, Ann Coulter is like what? She's tall, but she's, you know, 115 pounds soaking wet, maybe. I mean, they're afraid of her ideas. I mean, you know what I mean?
Yeah. And actually, they say, I mean, last night, they justified basically preemptive violence against people who were attempting to go because they said that Ann's speech is violence. Therefore, violence is justified.
Was there anything in her speech? Was there anything in her speech that they actually took issue with?
They took issue with everything, of course. Ann gave a speech called Adios America, and it was about her views on immigration in this country, which is a view that many Republicans and conservatives have. And unfortunately, university students, the most privileged in this country, are not being educated with the skills to be able to deal with ideas that they disagree with.
Interesting. And then there was some sort of white supremacist manifesto. Tell me about that.
Yeah, so what's been happening at University of Syracuse in New York is they have had mass protests and sit-ins and all these demands by radical left-wing students on campus. It's kind of a repeat of what happened in Mizzou, but this time at a different university, starting because of alleged racist incidents on campus. The most recent allegation that fueled the panic was that a white supremacist manifesto was said to have been sent to students from a library on campus. That turned out to actually be a hoax. While the other incidents are under investigation, I think what we see over and over is that the climate of panic and fear that administrators foster on campuses leads people to create hoaxes and to fall for hoaxes.
So, again, give us some more detail. I don't understand. And then I saw some headlines saying that the chancellor should resign, and I didn't understand why. What is going on?
Okay, so at the beginning of this month in November, there was a swastika that was drawn into the snow at a building nearby the campus. And this started a big, a lot of fear and panic on campus. And then racist graffiti was found in a bathroom and a hall on campus, which fueled more panic. And then incident after incident was being reported.
So is this, when you say racist, this swastika, was it anti-Semitic?
Well, the swastika, yes, is anti-Semitic, of course. The racist graffiti in the bathroom and the hallways on campus is said to be anti-Asian and anti-Black, although the actual words have never been confirmed or reported.
It's an interesting combination. But
right.
Okay.
And do we know that it was actually done by like white supremacists or whoever they're claiming it to be? Because we've seen in a lot of reports that things that people claim are done by these white supremacist group are actually done by people that are the ones pointing the fingers.
Right. It's a hoax.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right. It remains to be seen in some of these allegations at this particular university. We do know the most recent incident with the manifesto is a hoax. And the uncomfortable truth that people don't want to confront is that most incidents of racialized hate crimes at universities in this country turn out to be hoaxes.
Mm-hmm.
And so is anybody writing about that, talking about that? Is there...
Well, it's...
Are they people being prosecuted for that? Because this is... That in itself is trying to generate hate, and that should be a hate
crime.
Right,
right.
The university is still actively investigating these incidents, so we don't know who's responsible yet. But certainly there are radical activists taking advantage of what's happening to make illicit demands. One of them is they want the chancellor to resign. They have a whole bunch of other demands, and they're sitting in one particular building and occupying it to make their demands heard.
And what has the chancellor done that needs to make him resign? I'm confused.
Well, that's the thing with all these demands of resignations. It's always the accusations that the administration doesn't do enough to address systemic racism, threats of violence against students of color. They can never really be specific. But as we see over and over, you give an inch, they will demand more. It will never be enough.
And what is the position the school's taking in this case?
Well, so far they've expressed a lot of support for the students. They've been very transparent in their investigations, where it's led to. And they've been very quick in their turnaround response times. I mean, the incident from the fake white supremacist manifesto, that allegation came out just yesterday, and it was today that the administration revealed that their investigation found out to be a hoax. So I don't think they're giving in, but we'll see how long they can withstand the pressure, because this is no longer just a local story to New York. It's been covered in the national press, the Washington Post as well.
And when they say it's a hoax, do they mean perpetrated by like some teenagers locally, or somebody that's trying to get the chancellor to resign? They've created this whole narrative erroneously.
It was said that the manifesto was sent through Apple AirDrop to many students in the library. That never happened. Nobody received a manifesto. So it's unclear who started that lie originally, but it never happened.
It sounds all super crazy, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yes. And we're going to continue to see more as students are actively encouraged and rewarded for their radicalism and extremism on campuses.
Interesting. And rewarded in what sense? In the sense of the administration caving?
Well, you can see, look at Evergreen. You know what happened there in 2017 when they pushed out these academics who dared to take issue with this racial exclusion day. Those students who shut down the campus, shut down the classroom, some of them eventually were given awards on campus for their social justice activism.
Wow. Interesting. Have you seen the No Safe Spaces documentary that interviews that couple in detail?
I haven't yet, but I'm very familiar. Brett's become a good friend, and him and his wife are extremely brave for what they did at Evergreen. And we need more academics to stand up. But, if you don't have tenure, you risk to lose everything.
Well, in that case, the local police said they could not prevent them from being killed. And that they could not protect them, and they needed to leave because they were in imminent danger of bodily harm. That was the police communicated to them.
Sounds a lot like Portland police.
Yeah, fantastic.
Yeah.
All right, Andy. Well, we appreciate you spending a little time with us.
Yeah, thanks for your insight.
All right, Andy. Good luck. Talk
Thank
to you,
you
soon.
Okay.